Thanks everyone for being here and welcome on behalf of the campus and the archives at the National Center for Biological Sciences to this 40th edition of the public lecture series, a very special edition. My name is Venkat. I'm part of the team that runs the archives at NCBS, which is a center for the history of contemporary biology in India. But the lecture series that we run is a much broader series that sort of tries to look at the history of ideas. And we've been doing this over the last many years, and we try and invite distinguished people with a vast body of work where they can talk a little bit about the kinds of things they've been thinking about over the years. And we're very, very thrilled and honored to have Harsh Mandha here today with us. So I will step out of the way by just first giving a very brief introduction and then handing it over to Harsh to take over the talk. As most of you would know, Harsh Mandha is a human rights and peace worker, writer, columnist, researcher, and teacher. He's known most for his work with survivors of mass violence, hunger, homeless persons, and street children. He's been in public service in a variety of roles throughout his distinguished career. He worked in the Indian Administrative Services in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh for almost two decades, and is a founding member of the National Campaign for the People's Right to Information. As a member of the Prime Minister's National Advisory Council from June 2010 to 12, he convened the working groups of various bills, including the Food Security Bill, and co-convened the groups on the Communal and Targeted Violence Bills, Dalit and Minorities, Tribal Rights, amongst others. He was a Special Commissioner to the Supreme Court of India in the Right to Food case for 12 years up to 2017, during which time he investigated starvation deaths and reviewed implementation and directed public policy reform for advancing the right to food and nutrition in several states in the country. He's the author of a variety of books. I'm just going to pick two of them that have won from 2015, titled Looking Away, Inequality, Prejudice, and Indifference in New India. And more recently in 2019, titled Partitions of the Heart, Unmaking the Idea of India. Harsh teaches a variety of courses on poverty and governance at places like IIM Ahmedabad, the Open Society Internship for Rights and Governance in the European University. And in perhaps most relevant and most importantly here, in 2017, he established and led the national initiative Karwan-e-Mohabbat, or Caravan of Love, the Karwan, a wide-based collaborative civil society initiative of independent individuals, is a campaign of continuing journeys of solidarity and conscience to families affected by hate violence across India. We've been speaking to Harsh for many, many months now, hoping that we'd be able to invite him in person so that he could spend time with the students on campus. But as it were, we're still very, very fortunate and privileged to have him here to give his talk that's titled, Can a State Love Its People? Some Reflections on Governance. Harsh, thank you so much for being here, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Venkat, for your kind words and for inviting me. I too would have loved to spend some time on your campus, meeting your students. This subject that I'm speaking about, a computer screen is far too remote for the kind of conversation I hope to have with you over the next hour and a half. But this is the best we can do in the times that we live in. I look forward to the questions and answers that we would have at the end. So let me leap right in. Can a state love its people? The last summer, smoke from burning bodies clouded city skies 24/7 as funeral pyres spilled onto pavements and parks across the country. Anonymous bodies were lowered into crowded mass graves. Rotting corpses were washed ashore on riverbanks, half eaten by dogs and fish. It was a time when you had to die alone, your body was disposed of alone, and you were left to mourn alone. For those who have not lived through the 1947 partition riots and the Great Bengal Famine of 1943, like me, and I think like most of you in the audience, this Indian summer of 2021, when the COVID-19 virus ran amok, was the most calamitous that we have seen in our lifetimes. It was a time of wrenching suffering, grief that few homes and workplaces across the country were able to escape. It was a time of helpless fear and uncertainty. All you needed to save the lives of those you loved was suddenly in impossibly short supply. Hospital beds, oxygen, essential medicines, vaccines, ICU units, ambulances, doctors, nurses. Black markets thrived, even the price of wood for funerals and the priest's prayers spiraled. People died in hospital corridors or parking lots, sometimes inside hospital ICUs, choking to death because there was no oxygen. And then it ended as suddenly as it started. The country reopened. Cars, buses, bicycles, motorcycles crammed the streets and the byways again. People return to work, but fear hangs in the air even today, like clammy smog on a cold winter night. It never leaves us. The questions that haunt us are mostly unspoken. Will we be struck again? Will the tempest stir once more? Will it savage us even more than the last time? But already political leaders claim that there was no oxygen shortage, that the number of dead are much lower than the estimates of scientists and statisticians, that we are breaking all records in vaccinating our people, that our government had responded splendidly to protect its people from the deadly mutating virus, and that if people had suffered a little, it was the fault of the virus and of the people themselves for letting their guard down. After the pandemic ends, as the years pass, as generations move on, how will we remember the rampage of COVID-19, and especially the tumult, dread, and loss left in the trail of the ransack and pillage of the second wave? This is clear, that our wounds run so deep and so far that these cannot heal in one lifetime. But where will people allocate responsibility, culpability? Will they accept the official charge sheet that laid all blame on the virus and on people? Or will they recognize that they reaped the poisonous harvest that they themselves had sowed, of electing governments spectacularly bereft of both competence and concern? Through the century's greatest health calamity, the state was mostly absent. This must be remembered as the time of the great abandonment, when the people were abandoned by their state at a time when they needed it most. Our leaders displayed no remorse, accepted no blame, and announced no plans to prepare the country better for the next onslaught. Pandemic today has laid bare, above all, India's faltering moral center. Was the greatest humanitarian crisis of our lifetimes caused by leaders with a pathological lack of compassion? Pathological. Was it caused by their absence of love? As we rebuild on the other side of the pandemic, what will we bring forth? Can we, above all, bring in a state that cares? A state that, in the words of Gandhiji, wipes every tear from every eye? Can we bring in a state that loves its people? What would such a state look like? And is such a state feasible? This is, you know, what I'm going to talk to you about in the brief time that we have. Gandhiji left behind, you know, a few months before he was assassinated. He left behind a talisman. He said, when you are in doubt, in confusion, think about the weakest, the most vulnerable person you know. And then think, are the steps that we are going to take going to benefit that person, make her life better? And once you do that, he said, all your doubts will disappear. When we look at the policy choices that we have made during the lockdown, and indeed in the weeks and in the years and decades that preceded it, we will recognize that we somehow seem to have taken Gandhiji's talisman and thrown it into the deepest seas from which we cannot retrieve it. He also left behind a second, much lesser known talisman. And let me tell you about that. Anis Kidwai recalls her husband was a Congress worker. He died in the partition riots in 1947, trying to save lives. Anis Kidwai didn't go through even the iddat of her widowhood. And she came rushing to Gandhiji in Delhi in Birla House and said, I must make myself available for my country. And he spoke of many things, and she writes about his sadness, his despair. And then he said, my work, Beti, will not be done. My work will not be done until until a Muslim child cannot walk without fear in my city. When we look around at our Republic of Free India today, at public office, at policies, laws, public decisions, we realize how profoundly forgotten are these wise lessons of justice, kindness, inclusion, indeed of love, left behind by India's greatest son. Invisible to us in the middle class, India is passing through a massive economic and humanitarian crisis, a humongous explosion of hunger and the extinction of opportunities for decent work, indeed for any kind of work, and the continuing threat of infection and death. We might say, but this is the result of a virus that has brought, in fact, the whole world on its knees. But the truth is that the experience of other countries revealed that it was not the virus. What we suffered was not inevitable. It was the outcome of public policy choices. I believe indeed that the handling of the greatest health crisis of a century by a union government was nothing less than a crime against humanity. Let me illustrate this briefly. The choice of the lockdown itself. When the Prime Minister last March spoke to all of us on television, he was telling us, stay at home, work from home, keep social distance, wash your hands regularly, which seemed to us in the middle class perfectly reasonable advice. But while he was speaking, you know, all the years of my work with India's poorest people and with the homeless, I couldn't believe. I said, you know, has he forgotten? He's the Prime Minister of this whole country. Has he forgotten that there are many people in our cities actually who have no homes? The majority of people in any city live in slum shanties. When 10 people share a small, you know, 8x10 kacha room, and maybe 100 people share a common toilet, how can they keep any kind of distance? 9 out of 10 workers in this country are informal workers with no social security and protections. They eat what they can earn every day. How can they stay at home, work from home? Hunger will be the immediate obvious consequence. How can they wash their hands regularly when you don't have pipe water supply? And if you've seen any slum, people sort of burst forward when a tanker comes, spend maybe a fourth or a fifth of their day's earnings on a couple of pots of water. Please understand, and this is really important, that the lockdown, the protections that the lockdown offered, even in principle, did not extend to the large mass of the working poor. But it was the working poor who bore most of its hardest consequences. They, you know, were without, you know, this immediate explosion of hunger and joblessness. I was on the streets from the second day, working with the homeless, and many of my young colleagues decided to brave the infection and were with me on the streets. You know, literally thousands would gather, you know, pushing against each other when they heard that some food might be being distributed elsewhere. What kind of distance, what kind of dignity? And then we saw the migrants in millions who hit the streets. Many things broke down when the migrants moved out, you know, any kind of even pretension of labor protections and their rights. But something more fundamental broke down at that moment when millions hit the streets. And that was trust. I think India's poorest people have learned to not ignore their governments or indeed from their employers. But at least they believed that when true crises hit us, our governments and our employers will protect us. A million people hit the streets walking hundreds and hundreds of kilometers with great suffering last summer. There was, you know, we spent less than 1%, you know, among this, ours was the biggest lockdown on the planet, the greatest, in fact, that human history has ever seen, with among the smallest relief network packages, with Prabhat Patnaik and Jyoti Ghosh, two leading economists. We wrote a series of op-eds. I also went to the Supreme Court. We said that, you know, if the middle class is getting its salaries sitting at home, the least we can do is to, you know, give the equivalent of minimum wages to every Indian adult. And cost about 7,000 rupees per household, less than 3% of our GDP. Has been 3,000.
Harsh, if you can hear us, your voice is breaking quite a bit. And if you can hear us, could I request you to just maybe just have your video off just so that we can save some bandwidth?
Are we better now?
It is better now, but maybe just to help out, you could probably, if you want, you could just switch off the video just to save bandwidth.
I'll do that. Thank you. So friends, as I was saying, compared to most countries in the world, we refuse to provide, you know, significant, consistent cash transfers to all our working poor. And if we had done, the economy itself would also have not, you know, be seeing the worst recession that we have since independence. That could have been averted. There was also, you know, I won't spend much more time, but the open class bias of state policies, you know, when they finally started migrant trains, very reluctantly, the whole process by which you could, you know, get a seat on the trains, you had to get certificates, and these are people starving in the middle of lockdowns in distant cities and towns, how they would get medical certificates, how they would, you know, without smartphones, apply online and so on. But they struggled through this. But when flights were restarted, there was no requirement of quarantine at the other end. When flights were restarted, medical certificates were not required. There was no quarantine at the other end. The minister said this was just not practical. What was not practical for well-networked middle class people were seen as practical for migrants starving, desperate in cities far away from home. Just one more example, when students were caught up in quota and the government organized buses for their return, that was exactly the time when migrants were, you know, walking hundreds of kilometers, dying on the streets. I was, you know, I really was longing to see and hear one student, maybe one student in Kota, who would say, I refuse to get onto this bus and go home in safety until you provide these same services to the migrants, my brothers and sisters who are on the streets. But none of us did. It is important, as I said, for every one of us to understand that the deluge of suffering that surrounded us was the result of public policies made now, but also in the past. An economy that relies primarily on a reserve army of informal labor with no protections and rights, and one of the most highly privatized healthcare systems in the world. These policies were crafted and implemented by successive governments, not just the present one, without compassion, without transparency, and with hubris. This is the mirror the pandemic holds up to us. Do we have the courage to see it? Going beyond the pandemic, the greatest health emergency of the century also hit India at a time when democracy is more deeply threatened than at perhaps any other time in independent India, barring arguably the 18-month emergency. We see the erosion of various countervailing institutions necessary to counterbalance the power of the executive, parliament, cabinet, the opposition, and the judiciary. We see the erosion also of the independent media. We see a significant silencing of dissenting progressive voices in academia and in civil society. We see the criminalizing of all voices of dissent. The so-called BK16, the Bhima Koregaon. Let me just talk about one of the BK16, an 84-year-old priest, Father Stan Swami. I had the privilege to meet him, the Karwane Mohabbat, in its journeys, decided to also go and visit Stan Swami once he had been charged. And I met this man, you know, he was sick, he had Parkinson's, but he was, you know, determined and unbroken in any kind of way. And he spoke about, you know, he was living in one small room for decades. He had devoted his life for justice for the Adivasi people. He talked about how, you know, our biggest companies are coming in, occupying large tracts of Adivasi land and forests, and you know, not providing them any kind of legal relief and support. And when Adivasi youth have been protesting, literally hundreds and hundreds of them were locked up. And it was for this reason that he and Sudha Bhardwaj started a committee for the protection of the Adivasi youth who were jailed for peaceful dissent. And then we find both Stan Swami and Sudha Bhardwaj jailed in this extraordinary sort of allegations that they were involved in a Maoist conspiracy to assassinate the Prime Minister. We saw the Delhi riots, and again, I have no time to talk about it. But there was this whole buildup of hate through speeches, through the election campaign in Delhi, culminating, you know, the hate and the venom, culminating in the Delhi violence. And then we found that many of us were charged, including myself, were charged once again of being part of an urban Naxal conspiracy. There are several charge sheets where people, where the police claims that I, in a facade of peace, was fostering hatred in the anti-CA protests and so on. And the whole attempt is, and we've seen very brave young people who were peacefully protesting against the CA law, who are in jail under anti-terror laws, which it's very hard to actually look forward to a time when they can even prove their innocence and be free. Venkat, you know, if you can prepare for a short film that I wanted to see. There's never been a more frightening time to be a Muslim. There's also, you know, the distance that we have traveled from the promises of our constitution, that this would be a country of equal citizenship in every way to people of every faith, every caste, every language. So this is a film called Mazhab, which means religion.
मजहब नहीं सिखाता आपस में बैर रखना, मजहब नहीं सिखाता आपस में बैर रखना, गुलिस्तां ये बुलबुलों का कांटों से दूर रखना, गुलिस्तां ये बुलबुलों का कांटों से दूर रखना। मजहब नहीं सिखाता आपस में बैर रखना, मजहब नहीं सिखाता देखा था एक सपना, एक जहां ऐसा भी है जहां जिक्र सिर्फ मोहब्बत का ही है, होश जब खुले तब ये जाहिर हुआ, शायद ये तो फकत एक सपना ही है। क्या यही वो जमी है बेकसूरों के खून से यूं जो रंगी है, इतना भी सस्ता इंसान का खून नहीं, जो तुम इससे हुकूमते अपनी सुर्ख रंग गुलिस्ता पर फैला दिया क्यों सुर्ख रंग गुलिस्ता पर फैला दिया फिर भी है मेरा यही बयान मजहब नहीं सिखाता आपस में बैर रखना गुलिस्ता ये बुलबुलों का कांटों से दूर रखना गुलिस्ता ये बुलबुलों का कांटों से दूर रखना
Thank you. I was recalling Gandhiji's two dreams, two talismans to guide us in the future. He spoke about also a city, a country where a Muslim child does not have to move around without fear in her heart. Just yesterday, I was looking at this video that went around of a mob attacking a rickshaw puller, a Muslim rickshaw puller, demanding that he says Jai Shri Ram. And you watch his five-year-old daughter weeping, in fact, trying to protect her father against the mob. We've come a very, very long way from the India of Gandhiji's dreams. We have seen the epidemic of lynchings over recent years. Venkat spoke about the Karwan-e-Mohabbat, so let me speak a couple of lines about it. We were seeing, every week, 2 weeks, stories would come in of hate attacks, lynching of people by mobs. The data shows that about 86% of people killed in these lynchings in the last 8, 9, 10 years. Were Muslim, 8% were Dalit, that's about 94%. And even the remaining 6%, some of them are identity unknown. But what was terrifying and to me, even more than the lynchings, was the silence of our society and the partisanship of our, the open partisanship of our state. Was terrifying. The role that the police played was terrifying. But in the end, what about you? What about me? And what about our collective silences? Martin Luther King somewhere said that in the end, we will not remember the words of our enemies. We will remember the silences of our friends. And in order to break these silences, I write a column in the Indian Express. I made a call saying, from next month, I want to start a journey, the Karwan-e-Mohabbat or a caravan of love. And what I resolved was that we would go to the home of every person who's been lynched in any corner of the country. We would go like we would go to the homes of our own loved ones, to our family, to our friends. Above all, to tell them, you are not alone. There are many people in this country who still care, who share in your pain. To tell them, we seek for your forgiveness for what we have become as a country, which we have not been able to stop. To say, we will be with you as you struggle to join again the broken pieces of your life, as you fight for justice. And we will tell your story. We will write, we will make films. We will not allow people to forget. And the last is really important because, you know, I go to Germany sometimes, and every generation after the Holocaust asks their parents or their grandparents, how did you remain silent while all of this was happening? And one defense that many people give in German society was, but we did not know. And I was determined, and I remain determined, to not allow this defense for our silence. We told you, and we continue to tell you, and we will continue to tell you till we don't reach your conscience, till your heart does not, break, your conscience doesn't break. Until then, until your conscience doesn't pain unbearably, we will continue to tell the story. A number of people volunteered, writers, filmmakers, students, lawyers, human rights workers, and we traveled initially for 1 month, starting from Assam and ending up at Porbandar, where Gandhiji was born. But it was such a moving and it meant so much to people that we decided that we would continue our journeys. And right up till the lockdown, we made about 30 journeys in 14 states. And what we saw, you know, this terrifying condition in which we have reduced our Muslim sisters and brothers, we found firstly huge, you know, just so much cruelty within the killing that families began to say, I wish just goli mar de, they should have just, I wish they just shot him dead. I wish they just stabbed him and killed him. Why did they have to torture him so much? We found, you know, in story after story, you know, the eyes would be gouged out, the genitals would be smashed. Where has so much hatred come from? Then we found, you know, a pretty performative character. And let me explain this briefly. It's very similar to the African-American lynchings right from the late 19th century in America till almost 1960s. And these lynchings used to be like public events where the African-American man would be mutilated, his fingers, his genitals cut, and hung from a tree in the end. And families would gather as if it was like a picnic. And the purpose was this performative killing. And today that performative character has now been adopted by the by a video camera. Almost every lynching we found is accompanied by a video camera. The perpetrators themselves take the videos and put it out, and it's consumed across WhatsApp by lakhs and lakhs of people. And it is that, you know, that's what we found. We also found the police in almost every case, far from protecting the victims, protected the perpetrators, criminalized the victims, and then the silence. I mean, I almost began to beg in these journeys, somebody would have come and saved you, somebody would have intervened, and the story was always no one. And something has happened to our society, and that we need to recognize. There's been a legitimization of hate and bigotry. there must have been bigotry in our hearts. But in my childhood, growing up, I'm a partition family. My parents and their families suffered greatly in the violence of partition. But I never heard words of bigotry through my childhood, through my years in school and college. Something has changed around us. So India has become a very difficult time, not just to be a Muslim. It's become a very difficult time to be a working poor person or a farmer, to be a woman, to be a Dalit, to be an Adivasi, to be a conscientious journalist, to be an activist standing with the poor, upholding the constitution. And there is a foundation of an ongoing crisis of agriculture, of jobs, and the persistence of hunger. Are we standing witness really to the slow dying of democracy? John Keane, in an article recently in the Indian Express, spoke about democracy. He said, democracy is much more than pressing a button or marking a box on a ballot paper. It goes behind the mathematical certitude of elections and majority rule. It's not reducible to lawful rule through independent courts and attending local public meetings. Democracy is a whole way of life. It is freedom from hunger and humiliation and violence. Democracy is public disgust for callous employers who mistreat workers, being a pittance for unblocking stinking sewers and scraping shit from latrines. Democracy is saying no to every form of human and non-human indignity. It is respect for women, tenderness with children. It's access for jobs that bring satisfaction and sufficient reward to live comfortably, and so on. Can we speak of this in another way, I think? Is true democracy a way of life in which the state loves its people? For me, even more than the state failures, what I see is a crisis of our civilization. You know, when the lockdown happened, the middle class was happy. They felt protected. We were instructed to bang thalis. We banged thalis, to light candles. We lit candles. I'm amazed that how did we not think about what was happening to the working poor who surrounded us? The large mass of us were content to be protected, indifferent to the suffering of the poor. The absence of middle class empathy and outrage characterized what happened. I think we have turned into among the most uncaring people in the world. So let me ask, the pandemic and the unfolding economic and humanitarian crisis does offer a rare opportunity to rebuild better, but will we build back better? I was reading, for instance, about the Bombay plague of 1894. An administrator, a colonial administrator, wrote that if we have to prevent this in future, there are two things that come completely free, and that is clean air and clean water for everyone of the citizens, subjects at that time. And we must build our city in a way that ensures clean air and clean water for all our people. And look how we forgot those lessons. Will we forget again? Will we deepen further our uncaring after this pandemic? Will we continue to delight in our privilege, in our indifference to the working poor? The signs, sadly, are the latter. The union and many state governments have further reduced labor protections. I thought this was at least one time when we would finally say we need to give, some security of job and social protection to all our workers. But even the few protection that exists were dismantled after the pandemic. Investments, would we see greater investments in strengthening public health? But that has not happened. In fact, the budget showed, actually in real terms, a reduction in our public health investments. Instead, we've seen the crisis used to crush and jail dissenters. The wealth of the super rich grew manifold, amidst the crisis of mass hunger and job losses, Muslims remain the targets of public hate with Tablighi Jamaat and whatever. Looking at TV and most newspapers, would you even know that India is passing through its greatest humanitarian crisis of hunger and joblessness since independence? And indeed, the gravest threats to the survival of secular democracy since we became a republic. Can we still dare to hope? I believe we must. Three young people who were detained under anti-terror laws in Delhi were released recently on bail. Natasha Narwal, Devangana, and Asif Iqbal Tanha. Just watching their faces as they stood outside Tihar jail, their determination, nothing had crushed them. Asif Tanha, in fact, smuggled out and wore a mask, and on his mask he wrote, no NRC, no CAA. I met him and said, you know, why did you, you know, at least at that point, didn't you feel you needed to protect yourself? And he said, no, I wanted the government to know. You might jail us, you might do anything to us, but I will, we are not crushed. And we will fight to defend what our constitution guaranteed to every citizen. I asked him, don't you despair? And he replied in Urdu, he said, Mayusi kufr hai. Despair, he said, is blasphemy. In many ways, the idea of a caring state was the soul of the constitution that we, the people of India, gave ourselves. It is the reclaiming of this constitution that happened during the anti-CAA protests. I was, you know, in those 100 days, I was, you know, went really from city to city, town to village, where I was invited to speak. And it was a really exciting time because I saw a movement in which the national flag became the only flag, the symbol of protest. The icon of the protest was the constitution itself. Every gathering ended with a reading of the preamble of the constitution and a singing of the national anthem. What does the constitution say? And I would use words in Hindustani, you know, justice, insaf, freedom, liberty, azadi. Azadi, what kind of freedom? As Roosevelt had said, freedom to dissent, freedom of conscience, freedom of worship, freedom from fear, and freedom from want. Barabari, equality, equality of opportunity, equality of outcome, and above all, fraternity. Fraternity is the word, even among justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, something that we understand and practice, understand very little, rarely invoke, have almost completely forgotten. The Hindi word for fraternity in English is a problem because it literally means brotherhood, and we seem to have forgotten sisterhood. So the word that I really treasure much more is the Hindi word in the Hindi constitution, which is bandhuta, drawn from Sanskrit. Bandhuta literally means we are bound to and with each other. What is bandhuta? It means that, you know, when we watch that video of the little girl weeping because her father is being beaten, and she's trying to protect him, you think of her as your daughter. When Junaid, a young boy of 14, was killed, you know, stabbed to death on a train close to Delhi, I spontaneously wrote an article which started with the words, Junaid was my son. I did not know him when he was alive. his world was very different from mine. I'm an agnostic. He was studying the Quran. But in the way that he was killed, I mourn him as I mourn my son. The idea of fraternity, of bandhuta, is that when Pehlu Khan is being beaten on his back, I feel the pain on my back. When a Dalit girl is gang raped and killed, I mourn her with the same agony as I would if it was my own daughter. That was the idea of fraternity. And to my mind, that is, you know, the simpler word for fraternity is love. It is a society and a system of governance based around love. Ambedkar said something very profound about fraternity. He said the four pillars of the Constitution are justice, liberty, equality, fraternity. But he said even among these, the most fundamental is fraternity. And please understand carefully why he said this. He said without fraternity, you can have justice, liberty, and equality, but that will have to be enforced by the power of the state. But in our society, justice for all becomes a natural order of things. Equality becomes the natural order of things. Freedom for all is the natural order of things. It is caring, it is solidarity, it is compassion, it is radical love. The idea of, you know, there's also the idea, the question about who this country belongs to. And it's a struggle that goes back at least 100 years. When Gandhiji returned from South Africa, he took leadership of our freedom struggle. And central to this imagination of India, what kind of India would we build after the British left? It would be a humane and inclusive country. It would be a state that welcomes everybody of every faith, of every caste, of every gender, of every language, of every ethnicity, as equal citizens in every way. The majority of Indians, Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian, supported this idea and supported the leadership of Gandhiji and his imagination for our country. But there were oppositions, there were alternate ideas. The RSS and the Hindus Mahasabha spoke about a country which belonged basically to its Hindu population, where Muslims, Christians, and less explicitly Dalits and Adivasis would live. We would allow them to live as second-class citizens. We saw the Muslim League, which said India was not one country, but two countries, a Muslim India and a Hindu Pakistan. And we know where we reached. But I think of, you know, of radical love at that moment. A partition had happened. 1 million people had died in Hindu-Muslim riots. Another country had been constituted on the basis of religion. It was very easy for our leaders to say, okay, now you have a Muslim Pakistan, we will have a Hindu India. But Gandhiji, to his last breath, said to the Muslims, this is your country as much as it is anybody else's. And it is that humane, inclusive India that we are required to defend. You know, time is running out. Let me talk about a few more elements about a state that cares, a state that loves its people. Social rights, you know, social protection. Noam Chomsky, one of the world's best respected public intellectuals, he said, what is social protection? He said, social protection is ultimately the idea that we should take care of each other. I think that's a, you know, there's no more beautiful way of articulating the idea of social rights and social protection. And I believe that, you know, the time is long overdue when we should gather into a new social contract. Let us agree that there should be a floor of human dignity below which no one should be allowed to fall. No child should die because they can't afford health care. No child should have to labor rather than attend as good a school as your child and mine. No old person should have to work till her last day to eat food. There should be social protection, etc. Social housing, rural and urban employment guarantee, these elements, labor rights for all. All of this, universal social rights, to my mind, is fundamental also to a state that cares. One part of it, as I said earlier, was a state which welcomes people of all diversities of faith and caste, language, as equal citizens. The other is one that secures universal social rights for everybody, a floor of human dignity below which no one should be allowed to fall. You might think that this is far too idealistic an idea. Economists have calculated this, that this would cost about 10% of GDP. Where would the money come from? India's tax to GDP ratio is about 14%. Even the United States has a tax to GDP ratio of about 24%. We need to tax the super rich, an inheritance tax, some wealth tax on the super rich would be more than enough to ensure protection for all. I had spoken about the pandemic. What could the government have done differently? There are enough international examples. In fact, interestingly, the countries that have done the best by the people in the pandemic have been led by women. Taiwan.
Same issue like before. If I could just request you to switch off the video for a moment and just repeat what you said in the last sentence or so. I think we're facing the same issues like before. Sorry,
my video is again gone. Sorry.
Thank you.
May I continue?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Yeah. So I was saying that, it's interesting that the examples around the world about how governments, mostly governments led by women, interestingly, have dealt in a much more humane way with the pandemic. They've communicated with their people, they've explained to them the rationale of every decision, they've created large packages of relief, they've relied on science, they've spoken about their limitations, they've spoken about their dilemmas. Even the United Kingdom, which has a right-wing government, I work with homeless people. So I was talking to them about, what is the government doing for its homeless people? And I was surprised to find that they said that every homeless person has actually been checked in to hotels, 7-star hotels, 5-star hotels, and all other hotels through the lockdown so that they are taken care of. The government is paying the costs of their stay in these hotels. And I just thought, how long, maybe decades, centuries before I can imagine in India that a lockdown is done and India's poorest people are welcomed into India's 5-star, 7-star hotels. There's hope finally, and I'll just end with that. Where do I find hope? I find hope most of all by the actions of ordinary people through circles of kindness. I spoke about being on the streets through many months of the first lockdown, and I found, there was so much kindness of ordinary people, people coming out. And we saw this again through the second wave, people risking their lives, people organizing. In the second wave, it was organizing oxygen, organizing ambulances. In the first, we saw people providing food, water. I had a number of young people working with me. I remember asking one of them, "Aren't you frightened of the virus?" And he said, "I'm frightened of the virus, but much greater than my fear is their hunger." And, Can we learn from them? Can we learn from the most dispossessed of our people? I was in Nizamuddin among the homeless people. I was talking to this man and I said, how are you managing? He said, I had a little money saved up and I'm buying some food, but I can't buy food only for myself. I'm alone, but this family is next to me. They're small children. So I'm spending whatever money I have for as long as I have to feed them as I feed myself. We heard about these two young friends, one Hindu, one Muslim, who were returning from Surat, and they took care of each other until the Hindu boy died on travel and his Muslim friend was not willing to let him go. I love a story I read about, again, a Muslim laborer. He was desperate and he stole a bicycle because his son was disabled and he had to take him home. He left a note for the owner of the bicycle saying, I have harmed you, but this is the reason I had to look after my disabled child and I seek your forgiveness. And the owner of the bicycle chose then not to file a complaint with the police. It is these acts of love that you see around us. But most of all, I'm talking about the state. I'll talk about two examples and I'll end. One is, the leader across the world whom I admire most is the Prime Minister of New Zealand. She was in her mid-30s. And the kind of, love that she has shown. Let me just talk about, there was an attack on two mosques, which was videotaped, live cast by the attacker. And he killed 50 people worshiping in the mosque. And her immediate response was the very next day, she did exactly what we do in the Karawa. She covered her head in respect and she went to the homes of the people who had lost their loved ones. She embraced them. And you could see in her pain that she shared her pain and shared their pain. It was as simple as that. Learning from her, the next Friday prayers, women across New Zealand, including newsreaders, police women, covered their heads in respect and solidarity. People gathered outside mosques and joined their hands together and said, we will stand guard while you pray. The imam of the mosque where people had died gave a speech. He said, New Zealand has taught the world what it means to love. And he said, we are broken, but we are not brokenhearted. And I thought to myself, in India, our problem is we are not brokenhearted. And that shows how broken we have become. It is this idea of radical love that we need to learn. And who best to learn from it? And I'll end with a story about Gandhiji's last months. Gandhiji, when we, our grandparents were celebrating India's freedom, he chose to be far away in Calcutta, trying to quell the violence between Hindus and Muslims, the bloodbath. Finally, he decided to go on a fast and he went on a fast for 40 days. And many stories are written. I mean, I think it was probably the most glorious moment of his life. As he was able to bring the violence down until it completely ended. Many stories are told. One of them is that a very angry man, he was a Hindu man, he came, he threw a roti on Gandhiji's face and said, what you're doing is very, very wrong. How do you expect me to overcome my grief? My child was small, so small, my son. And this Muslim mob came and they killed him. And Gandhiji said, I can understand your pain and your sadness. But if you really want to overcome your pain, I will show you the way. find a little boy that small, a Muslim boy whose parents were killed by Hindu mobs. Adopt him as your own child. Raise him in his own faith, but as your own son. And maybe then you'll find the spaces in your heart to forgive and to heal. It is, you know, the leaders we have today are, you know, I think we contain within ourselves our best selves and our worst selves. I think Gandhiji's, you know, the greatness of Gandhi was that he was able to bring out our best selves. Our leaders of today, I think, are bringing out our worst selves. And it is, you know, it is for us to reimagine and rebuild a society and a state with, you know, which can teach us these lessons of love. That is our only future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Harsh. I could also just request you to have your video on just as an option. Thank you, I deeply appreciate it. Did you want to play the other video or should we just, should we switch to a discussion?
I was worried that it might end in, let's see at the end.
Okay. Thank you so much again. There's so much to think about and there are questions that are coming over. So I'm just gonna jump directly into the questions that have come in from the audience. And I'm going to request Rashi to voice her question, if you could. Rashi, are you able to do so? And if you can't, I'm happy to speak it out for you. Okay, I will do so. Rashi's question is, and I quote, can we achieve fraternity without eradicating appeasement politics? How can a democracy nurture leaders committed to each citizen over certain communities? End quote.
Good question. I wish I, you know, could talk to Rashi, but what kind of appeasement is she talking about? We've heard for a very long time a rationale by leaders of who have had their foundations in the RSS. That in, they're only correcting a policy of appeasement over decades, an appeasement of the Muslim community. We Hindus in this country are the majority, but we are suffering from discrimination because of the appeasement of the Muslim community. If that is your question more explicitly, you know, I think that there was something very important that Dr. Manmohan Singh did, one of his few really statesman-like actions. That was to appoint a committee called the Sachar Committee, where he basically just asked a collection of evidence of the condition of the Muslim people in India. And the Sachar Committee report actually has very strong evidence that the condition of India's Muslims was very similar to the two historically most oppressed communities, which was of the Dalits and the Adivasis. And they suffered from development deficits comparable to the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Therefore, you know, if you're saying that they've been appeased for 60 years, then they should be way ahead. On the other hand, caste Hindus dominate every walk of life, whether it's in academia, whether it is the media, whether it is politics, whether it's business. So we have a strange politics, and it's similar to what we saw in Germany as well, where you dominate, you control, but you also carry, you be nurtured to carry a sense of permanent grievance as well. And so this idea that, you know, Hindus are oppressed in this country has very wide because of appeasement policy. In my opinion, there has been an appeasement policy followed by virtually every government after Nehru's in this country. And that is an appeasement not of any community, but of people, extremist elements within who misuse religion, whether it is this religion or that, for propagating hate and division. So that is, and there's been an appeasement of Muslim fundamentalists, sometimes to a much greater extent to Hindu fundamentalists. But appeasing Hindu fundamentalists is not appeasing people of the Hindu faith. In fact, I think it destroys what is essential to any religion, mazhab nahi sikhata aapas mein bair rakhna. And likewise with Muslim fundamentalists. So I do believe that there has to be an end to an appeasement policy, but the appeasement is not of a community. It has never been, but of hate mongering elements within communities.
Thank you, Harsh. I think Rashi was not able to respond because her mic may not be active, but thank you again. I noticed that Deeba had her hand up, and Deeba, if you're able to unmute and speak or ask your question.
Yeah, so actually I didn't have a question, but there is such a rush of story that fills me as I listen. And listen, it's really not just individual stories, but a sea of stories. And with the passing of my parents, their stories are very much alive, both of whom grew up in pre-independent India, lived through much of the last century and the beginning of this century. Many times that we have grappled together, confronting questions that I have posed to them, others have asked us, come to my mind. And one of these is being a privileged Muslim, on being Muslim. I asked my mom once, so how can you call yourself a Muslim if you don't do Rosa or you don't do all these practices? She said, both my parents said they had no defense. They said, we have nothing to prove. Our language is Urdu. We read Urdu poetry. Our home has been a home to everyone in all of the neighborhoods we have lived in. We have nothing to prove. And I can say for myself as a privileged Muslim that the time my own Muslim identity hit me was the time of the Bombay riots, right, in 1992 and 93. It was time to speak up. And it was time to speak up in the face of stories being made up. And I just wanted to read something that I wrote at that time. Because I just feel things that one writes at a time are relevant for all time. They're not something that is a past. They become of the a part of the enduring present. So I wrote, I had seen all of my grandparents quietly unfold their little kaleens and say their namaz five times a day. The following generation had not followed practice, and yet they were Muslims. My parents had nothing to prove, nothing to explain. Being Muslim was a way of life. When the Babri Masjid was reduced to rubble in December 1992, faces of frightened Muslim children crowding railway platforms, desperately fleeing Bombay city, haunted me. The very people whose labor the city thrives on, the very people now being held accountable for insinuating the violence. I suddenly counted myself as Muslim too. It mattered to speak up, to be counted, to set the story right. I wrote a letter of indignation to a national daily, challenging the claim that this time the Muslims had asked for what they got. My parents' friends expressed concern about the threat my letter posed to our family. There was concern that we were too in danger. And ironically, I've been working on a piece on my parents, and my friends call it my labor of love, but I call it my expression in this time. And recently a filmmaker friend said, Deeba, be careful what you say and what you put out. be careful. And even though in my heart of hearts, I feel not why should you be afraid, but I feel the healing is going to take generations. And we have nothing to lose. We have nothing to lose to speak our minds, speak our feelings, dig deep. I've been living alone almost for the last few months, and it has been such a time of conversation, not preparing for what I will now do, but embracing what you really do care about. So I just wanted to share, thank you. Thank you for bringing the feelings to the fore.
Thank you so much, Deepa. I mean, my heart and mind also fill up with many responses. In the short time we have, let me say a couple of things. My family was, as I said, displaced from what is now Pakistan. They grew up in Rawalpindi. My parents' village saw huge violence. But my parents fortunately understood their religion to be one which was based on love. You know, as I grew into a teenager, I said that in our prayer room, I would like to have symbols of Allah and Christianity and the Hindu religion and the Sikh religion together. And my mother immediately agreed. And till their death, that was how home was. When I, in 2002, I left the IAS in my position in the IAS after the Gujarat massacre. I did not feel I could be part of government any longer. I had to fight a different battle. And I realized at that time how much, you know, how many of, you know, I lost about 80% of my relatives, my people I'd grown up. There has bigotry has enveloped large segments of our people. And you know, Venkat wanted me to speak about the state, but I do believe that the state is only going to be a reflection of society. And some of my relatives, I mean, they would come to me and say, you know, Harsh, we are ashamed of you. You're on the wrong side after all that we have suffered in partition. And I would tell them that because of all that we have suffered in partition, we more than anybody else should be sensitive to people who are suffering the same way today. So don't you see, I am on the wrong side, I am on the right side, you are on the wrong side when you don't stand with those who are suffering. And I think that, those drawing new lines of solidarity between people, you practice their religion and respect every other religion. And those who use religion to create hate, to create grievance, and to create divisions, that is, you know, the division is never between Hindu and Muslim, but between these. And we need to build our solidarities, learn to, you know, once again, to respect and people as they follow their beliefs in the way that we follow our own.
Thank you. Thank you, Deepa, for your comment, and Harsh for your follow-up response. I would like this conversation to continue here, but I, you know, for those of you who are listening on YouTube, and there are many of you there, just want to put out a note that, you know, maybe this is the last question that we'll put out on the live stream, but you're very, very welcome to come join on the Zoom platform just to continue the conversation as it might be if we were meeting in person. So I want to bring up Sohail's question, which is perhaps connected to what you just mentioned, Harsh. And Sohail asked, is the degree that a state cares a simple reflection of the degree that society or citizens care, or is there more to it than that?
A wonderful question. And it's something that has actually preoccupied me for a great part of my adult life. I wrote a book called Looking Away, Inequality, Prejudice, and Indifference in New India. And I spoke about how troubled I was, not so much by our inequality, but by the indifference of people of privilege to that inequality and to the mainstreaming of prejudice. And somewhere in that, you know, I've said that I spent my life trying to look at laws, policies, when I was in the IAS, when I was a member of the National Advisory Council, drafting laws and policies for a caring state, for a just and caring state. But I've reached a point now in my life and understanding where when I recognize that a just and caring state can only arise from a just and caring society. And, you know, I, therefore, I'm opposed a great deal, for instance, to the policies of our present government. But I don't think that's where the problem lies. The central problem doesn't lie there, because these are governments that we have selected, we have elected, we have supported. And so they are a reflection of our beliefs and values. And, you know, I think that we've seen one partition on the land of this country. What we are seeing happening today is millions of partitions of the hearts and minds. And it is those partitions that have to be fought before we can hope. And likewise, you know, if we cared enough about the migrant workers who hit the streets, incidentally, the largest probably displacement of human populations in human history, apart from the movement of slaves from Africa to the Americas, that, you know, even that moment, you know, the suffering, until we share the suffering of the other, once that happens, we in the middle class, you know, over and over again, when I was a child, I'm the son of an IAS officer, I don't recall through my childhood ever going to a private hospital or clinic. I always went to a government clinic and waited with everybody else. This was dismantled, and we instead celebrate the private healthcare system we built. 80% of India's trained doctors work for the for-profit sector. So we are left with just 20% for the public systems. And we don't care, because we are protected. What will happen to the poor is not something that ever has concerned us. We've created our beautiful schools, our beautiful private hospitals. You know, when there's electricity outages, we have our inverters. You know, where we have pollution, we have our purifiers. We have in a sense seceded. We have created our own world, which is privileged and happy, and we don't care about what happened to the rest. And I think it is that barrier that, if as a society we don't bridge, it is idle to believe that a government will suddenly emerge that bridges that gap.
Thank you so much, Harshan. Actually, turns out to be a reasonably good point to end the live stream while we continue the conversation here. So I do want to thank you sort of publicly again for being part of this conversation. I do hope we're able to invite you in person again in the future.
If you like, just before you close this, because that video was where I wanted to end. Just about the video, this is about, you know, about when I talk about changes in society, what am I looking for? At the very least, I'm looking for acts of kindness, of solidarity. And Mother Teresa said something very lovely. She said, not all of us are capable of doing great things, but all of us are capable of doing small things with great love. And, you know, just what is the kind of society that I imagine was lived by this young, humble Hindu boy called Chandan, who makes lemonade. And so if you could end this stage with that film, I'd be grateful.
सिकंजी तो सिकंजी है सर, उसका कोई धर्म नहीं है।
अच्छा लगता है आपस में मिल के बैठ के बनवाते हैं लोगों के लिए तो अच्छा लगता है।
मैं सिकंजी बनाता हूँ हमेशा, अच्छा लगता है लोग आते हैं।
ये तो रमज़ान का महीना तो चैरिटी और बेनेवोलेंस के लिए ही माना जाता है।
सिकंजी का ही सर ने दे रखा है, लोग सिकंजी पीते हैं तो मेरे को कहते हैं भाई अच्छा बनाया तुमने, बंदा सुबह से भूखा प्यासा है उसका गला गीला हो जाता है, उसके बाद तो मैं सबको सिकंजी पिलाता हूँ।
हमारे शॉप के अगल बगल सारे लोग काफ़ी रमज़ान का इंतज़ार करते हैं और कहते हैं भाई आप लोग का रमज़ान कब होगा।
हम तो भाई दस्तखान लगाते हैं, अब उसमें रोज़े वाला भी आ जाए, बगैर रोज़ेदार भी आ जाए, मुसलमान भी आ जाए, गैर मुस्लिम भी आ जाए, कोई ऐसा रोक टोक नहीं है और आते हैं लोग, आस पड़ोस से भी आते हैं। हमारे सामने लाला जी हैं, उनके भी हम इफ्तार भेजते हैं खाना और फ्रूट चाट।
शेर सारी जगह होता है, पूरी मार्केट में होता है, हम तो कई सालों से इकट्ठे खा रहे हैं, कई जगह से इफ्तार आती है और इफ्तार करवाते भी हैं, साथ में मिल के खाते हैं, पता ही नहीं चलता कि कौन क्या है और कौन कहाँ से आया है। सलाम वालेकुम बोलते हैं, मुसलमान राम राम बोलते हैं, यहाँ कोई ऐसी दिक्कत नहीं है, यहाँ हिंदुस्तान है पूरा।
बचपन से ही कर रहे हैं, कोई भी धर्म का हो, मैं खुद हिंदू हूँ लेकिन मेरे को अच्छा लगता है मोमडन्स के साथ अफ्तारी करना, मैं ईद पे भी जाता हूँ, मेरे फ्रेंड लोग आते हैं, हम लोग दिवाली, ऐसा कुछ नहीं है कि मोमडन हिंदू है, ऐसा हमारा सोच नहीं है, कभी घर से भी नहीं है और कभी ऐसा कहीं सोचा भी नहीं।
On that hopeful note,
thank you. Hey everybody, if you have a goal you're trying to accomplish, just check out Udemy right now.
That was unexpected. Anyway, on that hopeful note, thanks again everyone for being here, and thank you Harsh for being part of this conversation.